Time magazine.
Without the Beatles, it would have been a very different world, I think.
People of the century.
E.T. was really the story of my parents' divorce.
Tonight, the artists.
My father invented modern art.
The actors.
I didn't make any great movies.
The comedians.
She was fearless.
And she was gorgeous. She was such a dish.
Ay, caramba!
Who will make the CBS News Time 100 list?
I mean, you got a lot of nerve asking me a question like that. Did you ask the Beatles that?
A diva, it sounds wonderful, doesn't it?
The answers tonight, as we highlight the great artists and the great moments in movies, television, and music.
He had a great way of taking 32 bars of music and making it a little screenplay. And you believe that he was personally telling you this story.
There.
This is a CBS News special. People of the Century. The CBS News Time 100. With tonight's special guests, Steven Spielberg, Aretha Franklin, Mary Tyler Moore, Claude Picasso, Gloria Stewart, Wynton Marsalis, Oprah Winfrey, Candice Bergen, Matt Groening, and Bart Simpson. Now, here is CBS News correspondent Mike Wallace.
Good evening and welcome to the second in our series of broadcasts profiling the great personalities of the 20th century. On our program tonight and in this week's issue of Time magazine, the artists and entertainers who've inspired us, amused us, touched us, whose words and music and images captured the hopes and dreams, desires and disappointments of our time. First, Lucille Desiree Ball, her real name, a poor kid from a factory town in western New York State, who with her husband, Desi Arnaz, virtually invented modern TV comedy. She was television's greatest clown, and still is. And since TV signals go on in space forever, somewhere in a galaxy far away, they're probably watching Lucy.
How does the oven door get open?
The woman brought magic to the time that she was on stage.
My daughter is insane for Lucy. She's watched every episode about 75 times.
Of course, the chocolates. That assembly line of chocolates and then in the mouth and in the hair and in the hat. Brilliant, brilliant comedy.
That wonderful scene where she's stomping the grapes. Her concept of comedy was so pure and so gifted.
I am honored to have been asked to talk about her.
Why?
Because I think she was probably the most gifted actress, performer, comedian that ever lived.
Hollywood is famous for its pretty girls who trek here from every part of the world.
Lucy arrived in Hollywood in 1933.
Here's Busby Berkeley, famous dance director and
to work for the great Busby Berkeley in a comedy called Roman Scandals.
You know, I was 22 and brand new, and it was a wonderful experience.
Gloria Stewart was the star.
Always have your way. If he likes you in a negligee.
And Lucille Ball was just another face in the chorus.
If you want to be loved.
That's Lucy.
A young model trying to get noticed.
She stood out because every once in a while she'd clown a little. And people would laugh. The girls would laugh. We would laugh and so forth.
She would make 75 movies, sharpening her skill at comedy.
Wouldn't it be much simpler to call a cab, Mom?
Lucy was in a movie with my father before she lucified herself, before she exaggerated her features.
You said you're not angry, are you?
Angry? Why should I be angry?
And she was so gorgeous. She was such a dish.
Oh, I love.
The Lucification started in 1943 when she signed with MGM. Executives didn't like her natural brown hair. Her hairdresser recalled, There were enough blondes in Hollywood, so I thought, why not a redhead?
Lucille Ball, come on!
In radio, she learned how to work in front of a live audience.
Sesame,
Hey, what am I going to get, a kiss or a quart of milk?
And when television beckoned, she convinced nervous CBS executives that an audience was crucial.
That was an instant barometer. That's why I insisted on working with an audience. We could tell right then and there whether we were on the right track or not.
Good night.
She not only became television's biggest star, she wound up owning the studio where I Love Lucy was filmed. The first woman to run a major Hollywood production company.
She was an icon in this town?
Oh. An icon not only as a comedian, but as a businesswoman. She was such a crack businesswoman.
She, I guess, had a reputation, not for being tough, that's not the word, but... Mm-hmm. But
knowing what she wanted.
Vitamin, vegetable, contains... Vitamins, meat, and vegetables, and minerals.
She was fearless. That's one of the reasons why most of us don't ever try that kind of comedy. Because we're afraid it won't be funny. She didn't care. She knew she was funny. She knew it was going to be okay.
I'm happy that I brought laughter. I loved doing what I was doing, so I felt very lucky.
Our CBS News Time 100 list tonight includes two other television originals. Oprah Winfrey, who's molded the TV talk show into a kind of national town hall and reading room, and Jim Henson, the father of the Muppets, who created a whole new way to entertain kids and teach them something, too.
It goes Q-R-S-T-U-V. You're just teasing me.
It's hard to find anyone under 40 who didn't learn something from Jim Henson. For over 30 years, his Muppets have been teaching kids about everything from reading to racial tolerance.
20!
Turning writing and arithmetic into fun.
I always remember my father just working intensely hard. And at the same time, he always wanted to goof around and he always wanted to be silly. So he was working and he was making sure the work was silly at the same time.
My ancestor, the Viking, was terrible at plundering and pillaging.
He was?
Yes, he plundered his plundering and he blundered.
Darn, I missed. You know, that's the first thing to go on a frog, his tongue.
He made Kermit out of an old coat of my grandmother's. That character was very similar to him and kind of grew with him.
There's a certain similarity there, certainly.
This is all very complicated. I don't understand this at all.
He was trying to celebrate uniqueness. They're always the underdogs, always flawed.
Are you getting a good shot, boys?
And yet, the Muppets always have very, very big dreams. He taught the world the lesson that it's good to be who you are.
I am, do I know who you are?
Hey! Good! You're so good to us!
When I was a little girl in Mississippi in the 50s, looking through the screen porch at my grandmother boiling a pot of clothes, somehow I knew that that would not be my life. When I first started in television,
the very first National Oprah Winfrey Show!
The idea of being a black woman and being even allowed to be on television was such a novelty. I was happy just to have a job for a long time. And then I realized the power of this medium.
30 seconds.
The responses I was getting from people.
I need some Kleenex.
I received a letter once from a viewer that said, watching you be yourself every day makes me want to be more myself.
There was just so much excitement around. It's like, I have to do this. And I cried at the end, and it was because I finished it.
It was the first book you read at 40 years old?
Yes.
I could weep for you.
I've been weeping all day.
So when I realized it's that amazing. That is what we had the power to do, I no longer wanted to just do good television. I wanted to have a message that was good for the people to hear and see.
It was so much fun getting here, too.
Three down, 17 to go. Next, the man with the horn. And later, the man behind the camera.
Every time a movie works and people respond to it, It's a tremendous reward, but it's also kind of surprising.
See. As sounds of the century go, a few are unmistakable, and that is one of them, the music of Louis Armstrong. Call him Louis, as most people did, or Louis, as he preferred, or Satchmo, shorthand for Satchelmouth, one of his nicknames. Whatever the name, he was an absolute original with a heart as big and true as the sounds that came from his horn. He was born on the banks of the mighty Mississippi at the dawn of the new century, a dirt poor kid from New Orleans who changed the face of music.
He was given a gift to communicate to people. He was like the gift of the 20th century. Armstrong is in everybody. Everybody that sings or plays American music has Armstrong in it.
In the New Orleans where Armstrong grew up, as now, there was music everywhere. He learned the ropes, playing in bars and bordellos.
Well, he grew up in a street called Jane Alley, where the poorest prostitutes lived. It was the roughest neighborhood in a rough time.
Our guide to the world of Louis Armstrong is another son of New Orleans, trumpeter Wynton Marsalis.
What characterized the Armstrong sound?
First, just to make the horn sound like a voice. If you're playing a trumpet, traditionally, it's just... It's just straight. Right. Now you hear this guy playing... And you're wondering, man, you know, what, how is he making that sound? Then he's glistening, making these sounds like a... It's like a spiritual flame that runs through his sound.
As a young man, he took his music to Chicago.
Right there in Chicago, on State Street between 31st and 32nd Street.
The word spread, you've got to hear Armstrong hit those high notes.
It was lined up for blocks every night to hear that little boy hit that high.
He was a great influence on musicians, but singers too, no?
Oh, yeah. His sense of phrasing became the way to phrase. When all these singers want to sing kind of loose, like Bing Crosby.
Jazz is king, jazz is the thing that folks dig bad.
All of the singers, Frank Sinatra.
Louis Armstrong traveled the world. Ambassador Satch, they called him. He had his own ideas about health and fitness, believing in the therapeutic value of a killer laxative called Swiss Chris.
Don't think for once that Swiss Chris wasn't the rudimentals of my life.
What were the rudimentals of your life?
Swiss Chris, I mean, my slogan is leave it all behind you, Daddy.
He had to have his laxative, and he had to have his relaxing. He had to have him a little marijuana to relax him.
He did. He liked the weed.
He loved it. His weed, if he needed that, then let's get him some.
Almost to the end, Louis Armstrong stayed on the road. One more town, one more show.
This man was 60-something years old going around the world doing one-nighters. He would sit up at night at a typewriter writing letters to his fans. He's a certain type of man, the greatest genius who is also the most humble.
Next, four more revolutionaries who changed the course of music and art and literature in the 20th century, reshaping the way that we hear and see and think.
First, there is the Russian composer Igor Stravinsky. His masterpiece, The Rite of Spring, touched off a concert hall riot when it premiered in 1913. 85 years later, Stravinsky's music could serve as the soundtrack to a turbulent century. Bold, violent, disturbing. There is the Irish writer James Joyce, who changed the way novels are written. Joyce pioneered stream of consciousness. Ideas and images tumble from his characters' minds like shards of glass in a kaleidoscope. His masterpiece, Ulysses, was published in 1922. That same year, T.S. Eliot published The Wasteland, his epic poem on the emptiness of modern life.
Of incandescent terror.
Eliot's work ranged from poetry to plays to the children's verses that inspired the musical Cats. There is the Spanish artist Pablo Picasso, who did for painting what Stravinsky did for music. Picasso took things apart and put them together again in new and astonishing ways. A man of huge appetites for art, for women, for life.
My father invented modern art, in a way. That's basically it.
Picasso's dying words, drink to me.
Next, on to the movies. Check your choices for filmmakers of the century against ours.
I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody.
Century. Preeminent among them at century's end, Steven Spielberg. He is the master of the blockbuster movie. Like Hitchcock and Disney before him, Spielberg has become a household name. But as he will tell you, his roots go back to another Hollywood icon.
It was 1952 when Cecil B. DeMille, then the master of the movie spectacular, made his circus film The Greatest Show on Earth. A six-year-old who saw it in Scottsdale, Arizona, was impressed.
That made me want to play with trains, because there's a huge train wreck in the middle of that movie. I had a vinyl train set as I was growing up. I used to crash the trains together all the time. And I just remember borrowing my parents' movie camera and making a movie of the last train wreck. And then I would look at the film over and over and over again to satisfy whatever kind of destruction lust I had in the first place. And that was probably when I realized something. I discovered I could manipulate images and satisfy myself to a degree.
From then on, when his dad wasn't taking pictures of Steven, Steven was taking pictures of burning dollhouses, directing his sisters, and as a teenager, directing his pals in World War II epics based on his father's war experience.
My dad was a radio man aboard a B-25 in the Burma campaign.
So he was in danger, and he probably came back and told little Steven stories.
He told me a lot of stories that inspired me, that when I first began making little movies in 8mm, I wanted to make war movies to do on film what my dad did in real life.
The war was a theme he had returned to again and again over the years. Empire of the Sun. Schindler's List. And his latest, about to be released, Saving Private Ryan. The Spielberg World War II points up mankind's great failing of the 20th century.
Which is tolerance. The 20th century has not managed to teach anyone tolerance. I'm hoping the 21st century is another chance, second chance at another 100 years to teach tolerance.
And that, of course, is what you're trying to do. That's what Schindler's List, that's what Amistad.
And even Saving Private Ryan to a certain extent.
And Here you have the two faces of Steven Spielberg. He makes serious films about moral issues. He makes adventure films that appeal to the kid in all of us.
My favorite Spielberg movie remains E.T.
Thank you. You and my kids. E.T. was really the story of my parents' divorce, which I think few people have been able to gather from the results. I came up with the story really based on loneliness, about a boy who's isolated, who lives with his mom, and his father's out of the house, and it's kind of a sort of a cry for help.
Out.
And E.T. is the answer to his prayer.
Mr. Spielberg.
By all standards, he remains the most powerful man in Hollywood.
Action.
Who still gets butterflies when a new film of his comes out.
Every time a movie works and people respond to it, you know, it's a tremendous reward, but it's also kind of surprising.
Surprising, really?
Yeah, really. Really.
One of the next projects he's considering, a film about aviator Charles Lindbergh.
Why Charles Lindbergh? Why did this attract you so?
I always thought Charles Lindbergh was a great pioneer, a great 20th century icon. One thing is I love flying. I mean, I love the whole nature of flight, what it means. I'm afraid to fly, by the way. I have to throw that in. I'm terrified of flying, which is probably why I'm attracted to it, because I'm usually attracted to the things that scare me.
As for his own status as an American icon, Steven Spielberg defers to someone else.
If I had to pick, you know, my favorite director, living director of the 20th century, I'd have Marty Scorsese sitting here, not me. When all the books are written, you know, he'll be declared along with John Ford and Griffith and Hitchcock, one of the great directors of all time. I think he is.
Next, Marlon Brando, certainly the most influential actor of our time. Also the most eccentric and the most puzzling. Brando has marched always to his very own drummer. At his worst, he has done forgettable films solely for the money. At his best, he has lit up the stage and screen with a brilliance unrivaled.
Estella!
Consider the many faces of Marlon Brando. Adonis in a t-shirt in Streetcar Named Desire. The face of evil in Apocalypse Now. Butch biker icon in The Wild One. Sexual provocateur in Last Tango in Paris.
I'm going to make him an offer he can't refuse.
He was godfather to a whole generation of American actors who tried to make it look not like acting, but like life.
I don't want his mother to see him this way.
He mumbled, he stumbled, and he believed in the power of illusion.
Good.
Everybody in this life is an actor. You say, hi, how are you? You son of a bitch. And people don't say what they want.
You know, I've been on to you from the start.
And he had taken Broadway by storm at age 23 in Streetcar, broke his nose in a backstage accident, and left it crooked because he liked the look of it.
You don't understand. I could have had class. I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody instead of a bum.
By age 30, he'd won an Oscar for On the Waterfront and was lionized as the greatest American actor of his time.
Since I don't do anything else well, and up to this time I haven't decided what else I would like to do, I might as well put all my energies into being as good an actor as I can.
Off screen, he championed the Native American cause. On the set, he developed a reputation for chewing up and spitting out directors and producers. And he came to regard acting as a chore.
I find it odious, unpleasant. I don't find acting satisfying. I'm much more interested in writing.
He thumbed his nose at Hollywood in other ways. His waistline expanded to widescreen proportions.
It doesn't make that much of a difference whether you're fat or thin in life. It's just that if you're a good person.
His family life, always complicated, turned upside down in recent years. His son Christian convicted of manslaughter in a sensational trial. His daughter Cheyenne a suicide.
Wasn't enough time, Michael. Wasn't enough time.
We'll get there, Pop. We'll get there.
Life, Marlon Brando likes to say, is a mystery, a riddle. He's lived it as he pleased, without apologies. and he's unsentimental about his work and his fame.
I didn't make any great movies. There's no such thing as a great movie. You know what's great? A Rembrandt painting. Mozart chamber music.
Coming up, from soul to rock and roll, the great musicians of the century.
Love what I do. There's a lot of adrenaline going, and there's nothing like it.
In the world of rock, 1964 was a defining year. The Beatles toured the United States. Bob Dylan sang The Times They Are A-Changin'. And together they changed the face of popular music. The Fab Four from Liverpool and the serious, mysterious fellow from Duluth, Minnesota.
The date was February 9th, 1964.
The Beatles!
It was the night Ed Sullivan introduced the Beatles to America.
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow,
you know, Beatles bring joy into the world. This is the happiness. We forget our cares when we hear Beatle records.
Their performance changed popular music forever. A cultural revolution was born.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
It was a revolution forged by the raw sexuality of Elvis Presley.
You know, you went to see those movies with Elvis or something in it when we were still in Liverpool, and you'd see everybody waiting to see him, right? And I'd be waiting there, too. And they'd all scream when he came on the screen. So we thought.
By the time the lads from Liverpool took America by storm, a new youth culture was being born. The culture whose password was rebellion. And no one amplified this rebellious spirit more than Bob Dylan.
Come gather round, people, wherever you roam.
He was our idol.
Bob was our hero.
We listened to his album and it really gave us a buzz and we played it constantly.
Then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone, for the times, they are a-changing.
Born Robert Zimmerman in 1941, Dylan came down from Minnesota to compose song poems full of anger and alienation.
Don't follow leaders or watch the parking meters.
Kids loved him because he ratified their rebellion and he showed no respect.
Do you care about what you're saying?
How can I answer that if you got the nerve to ask me? I mean, you got a lot of nerve asking me a question like that. Do you ask the Beatles that?
Dylan and the Beatles. They were the spirit carriers for a new generation, the baby boomers. A generation that demanded freedom, sexual liberation, drugs, and most especially, rock and roll music.
We don't love to change the world.
Music that changed the times. Aretha Franklin is a minister's daughter from Detroit who cut her first album at 18, appeared in the cover of Time at age 26. She sings of love and respect and what it means to be a woman with a ferocious combination of spirituality and sex. She is the Queen of Soul, the first woman named the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, who joins tonight our CBS News Time 100 list.
The Queen of Soul!
What keeps me on the road? My love of music, the fans. Love what I do. There's a lot of adrenaline going, and there's nothing like it.
Believe me when I tell you that I've been hurt myself.
To know the power of Aretha Franklin is simply to hear her voice.
And nobody else.
When she comes on stage, you know she's in comfortable command. For almost 40 years, she has continued to earn her royal title. first conferred on her by an admiring disc jockey.
The Queen of Soul started in the 60s. One night, the biggest jock in Chicago walked on stage with the crown, and he just walked over to the piano and he put it on my head.
She's won the most Grammys of any female performer. She's had over 40 hits on the Billboard pop charts. But her true legacy is spelled out by these seven letters.
I-E-S-B-C-T.
Shy and quiet, off stage. On stage, she urges women to raise their voices and demand their due.
You better think about the consequences of your act.
Oh, shut up, woman.
You better think about what you're trying to do to me. Yeah. Think. Let your mind go at yourself, even for freedom.
There were demons in her own life, failed marriages, family tragedies, but from her very first recording session, she found salvation in her music.
I walked in the studio and I heard my music playing for the first time, and it just brought me to tears, and I just started boo-hooing all over the place.
You make me this. You make me.
Her stage persona and her temperament earned her another title, the Diva.
A diva, it sounds wonderful, doesn't it? I love it.
But in the end, she's held tight to the gospel roots that inform all her songs and her life.
I never left the church. The church has always been within me. And we have church often in concert.
Some short profiles now from our gallery of innovators who made their mark on the 20th century.
Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein. They revolutionized the Broadway musical in 1943 with Oklahoma.
Where the wind comes sweeping down the plain.
Merging the songs and the dance and the drama all into one. They gave us South Pacific, The King and I, The Sound of Music. A body of work as corny as Kansas in August, as normal as blueberry pie. Martha Graham, she freed modern dance from the shackles of tradition. Her dancers went barefoot, writhed on the floor, and were not afraid to show the sweat and strain of their work. Martha Graham lived to be 96. Le Corbusier, perhaps the most influential architect of the 20th century. The modern style, glass, concrete, and stucco, has its roots in his work. And Coco Chanel, the century's prime arbiter of women's fashion, who made clothes and hair and makeup simple, direct. In the 20s, she invented both the little black dress and Chanel No. 5, though her own favorite perfume was Chanel No. 19.
Still to come, cartoons and comedians, the people who make us laugh.
You can always look at this family on TV and go, I don't have it as bad as The Simpsons.
Charlie Chaplin, as a kid, he lost his mother to madness, his father to drink. But somehow, out of poverty and loneliness, Chaplin transformed himself, becoming a headliner in the British music halls. And then, in the new world of the movies, the first real superstar.
Anybody hoping to make it in comedy should invest in some Chaplin tapes. It's all there. The physical grace, the funny little double takes, the unbelievable sense of timing. There's no great comedian who doesn't owe something to Charlie, Steve Martin, Jack Benny, Lucy. Cary Grant was such a fan of the Chaplin film City Lights, he even married Virginia Cherryl, the flower girl. What makes Chaplin's Tramp so funny and so human is the sense of dignity he manages even when things are falling apart. A trait you can trace from Chaplin to W.C. Fields to Inspector Clouseau to Cosmo Kramer. Smile is the tune he wrote. Watching him, it's impossible not to. When the Gold Rush came out in 1925, a theater projectionist in Berlin thought the bit with the dancing dinner rolls was so funny, he just backed up the film and played it over again. As good a tribute as any to the man who invented screen comedy.
If Chaplin captured the optimism and hope of the century's early decades, the pessimism and hype of our times are duly noted by our next honoree, social critic Bart Simpson. You may ask, what's a cartoon character doing on our list? The answer? He's as funny as Lucy, as angry as Bob Dylan, and almost as deep as James Joyce.
In the very first appearance of The Simpsons in 1987, Bart was already asking
the big questions.
Dad?
Yeah?
What is the mind? Is it just a system of impulses?
He hasn't gotten any decent answers in 11 years. Tangible. But then,
relax.
Who has?
What is mind? No matter. What is matter? Never mind.
The Simpsons is a rare gem in the television wasteland. Sly and cynical and politically incorrect.
Hey, immigrants! Beat it! Country's full!
At its center is Bart.
Ay, caramba!
An underachiever for our time.
Bart is a combination of myself as a child and all my bad, bad friends in school. And it's taken the worst aspects of all of us and putting them together in one lovable lump of a boy.
What the hell is this?
Bart lives in a land of toxic waste, junk food, trash television, and bad role models. In other words, America in the 90s.
Hey, they forgot my corn dog.
You can always look at this family on TV and go, I don't have it as bad as The Simpsons. You can feel superior to them. Certainly you're not as ugly as The Simpsons.
The show's roots come more from programs like All in the Family than other cartoons. What has elevated Bart to star status is the writing. A torrent of one-liners, asides, and obscure references more sophisticated than any sitcom.
Pablo Neruda said laughter is the language of the soul.
I am familiar with the works of Pablo Neruda.
It all proves there is still room for sharp satire on television.
Can't let Dad see me playing hooky.
I can't let the boys see me skipping work.
In the character of a world-weary 10-year-old picking his way through an American minefield of dolts and deceit.
Sucker.
Bart is totally anti-solemnity. He's anti-pomposity.
Whoa, that's good squishy.
So in a way, he's like Groucho Marx if Groucho Marx were 10 years old and really, you know, had been eating a lot of heavily sugared breakfast cereals.
Okay, we're young, rich, and full of sugar. What do we do?
You know, he's a little hyper.
So Bart Simpson joins the CBS News Time 100 list.
I did it.
Wow!
And his creator is touched.
Why I think it's great that he made the list in this century is because probably in any previous century, you know, he'd be hanged.
And now we'll go to Springfield, to Bart's hometown, for his reaction.
There's only one thing to do at a moment like this. Strut.
And then there was one. The final person on tonight's CBS News Time 100 list. Half a century in the spotlight. Who is it? Stay tuned.
Tonight on Dave.
We have a fantastic show for you.
Boxing champ Evander Holyfield and the Truman Show's...
formed them all. Frank Sinatra had a song on the charts every year from 1945 to 1995, half a century. He knew his way around the lyrics to America's great popular songs like nobody else. He could swagger, and he could break your heart. Back in 1965, CBS News cameras were there at a Hollywood studio as he made one of his best-known and most beautiful recordings.
When I was 17, it was a very good year. It was a very good year for small town girls and soft summer nights.
My name is Frank Sinatra.
We'd hide from the lights on the village green. When I was 17.
Listen to this crowd as Frankie makes his entrance.
Better stand this way, they'll never see you. Hey,
Bogart once told me, the only thing you owe the public is a good performance.
When I was 21, it was a very good year. It was a very good year for city girls who lived up the stairs. With all that perfumed hair, and it came undone when I was 21.
Let's go Hollywood backstage as Frank Sinatra's handprints are engraved in history.
He had a great way of taking 32 bars of music and making it a little screenplay. It was a beginning, a middle, and an end, and you believed that he was personally telling you this story.
When I was 35, it was a very good year.
Jeff.
It was a very good year for blue-blooded girls of independent means. We'd ride in limousines. Their chauffeurs would drive. When I was 35.
I would like to be remembered as a man who brought an innovation to popular singing. A man who had a wonderful time living his life. Good friends. Fine family. And I don't think I could ask for anything more than that, actually.
But now the days are short. I'm in the autumn of the year. And now I think of my life as vintage wine from fine old. And clear. It was a very good year.
From Sinatra to Stravinsky, there they are, the artists and entertainers of the century. On our next broadcast, builders and titans, the captains of commerce and cyberspace who put their stamp on everything from the Model T to Windows 98. We welcome your suggestions. Both CBS News and Time have websites so you can nominate your candidates for People of the Century. And now for CBS News and Time Magazine, I'm Mike Wallace. Good night.
Next week on...